When you turn on a light bulb, your room instantly lights up. Light doesn't seem to travel at all. But over the vast distances of the universe, you actually start to notice this travel time. Even the sun, which is 93 million miles away, the light from it takes 8 minutes to get to us. When we look at the stars, we start to think of distances in terms of light years, because it takes years for the light to get from them to us. And when we look at the galaxies, we're talking about millions or even billions of light years. So in essence, looking at the farthest objects also means looking back in time. We see these dark lines when we look at the sun's spectrum. We see the same lines in the spectra from distant galaxies, except they are shifted to longer wavelengths, towards the red end of the spectrum. So we say their light is redshifted. The usual explanation for this redshift is that because the galaxies are very distant, so due to the expansion of the universe, they will be receding from the Earth at very high speed, and hence their light will be Doppler shifted to longer wavelengths. This is also known as a cosmological redshift. Measuring how much a given line has been shifted can tell you how old this light is and also the distance to the source. So we want you to keep in mind that in cosmology, observing larger redshifts means we are looking at a very distant source and we are also looking far back in time. Radio astronomy was booming in the 1950s. After World War II, many slightly used anti-aircraft antennas suddenly became available for civilian use. Astronomers took that opportunity and pointed them to the sky. They observed a very bright radio source, 3C273. But what was puzzling was its spectra. If it's a star, it should have recognizable fingerprints of atoms, such as hydrogen. But the observed spectral lines were a complete mystery. They didn't match the spectra of any known chemical element. They dubbed it a quasi-stellar radio object, or quasar. It was in 1963 when a Dutch-American astronomer Martin Schmidt, sitting in his office at Caltech, had a remarkable realization that we are in fact looking at the spectral signature of hydrogen. It just had been shifted to the red end of the spectrum due to the expansion of the universe. 3C273 was not a nearby star, but something traveling away from us at 30,000 miles per second and is 3 billion light years away. This discovery even placed him on the cover of Time magazine in 1966. Today, we understand quasars as the supermassive black holes of millions or even billions of solar masses surrounded by an accretion disk of gas. This gas races around the black hole, making it very hot and bright. So bright that a quasar is thousands of times more luminous than a galaxy like our Milky Way. That's what first made them so confusing. Given their extreme distance, the apparent luminosity is closer to what would be expected from a much closer object. We can understand a lot about the cosmic structures and history of the universe from the light of a distant quasar. As it has traveled vast distances for billions of years, so it definitely has a story to tell. We understand that quasars are incredibly luminous and emit at all wavelengths. Therefore, quasars will in general be visible at much larger distances than ordinary galaxies. If one is trying to map out the structure of the universe on large scales, that extra range can make a big difference. This is what a typical spectrum from a quasar looks like. Comparing this with the hydrogen spectra immediately tells you that this peak corresponds to the Lyman alpha line of the hydrogen spectrum. But it is redshifted, and the redshift value gives you the distance to the quasar and how old this light is. If we focus on this part of the spectrum, we see this dense region of dark lines. In atomic physics, the interaction of photons with the atoms is a two-way street. When an electron jumps to a smaller orbit, a photon is created. Conversely, the atom can also absorb a photon of the right energy, causing the electron to jump to a larger orbit. For a hydrogen atom, a transition from the second to the first orbit emits a photon of wavelength 1216 angstroms. This is known as the Lyman alpha emission. Similarly, we have Lyman alpha absorption. But why do we have so many absorption lines in this region? For that, first imagine a source that is emitting photons of all wavelengths and a cloud of neutral hydrogen gas. On the right side, we will measure the flux we will receive. As mentioned earlier, a hydrogen atom will only absorb a photon of wavelength 1216 angstroms, and it is nearly transparent to every other photon. So if we plot the flux versus the wavelength, then we expect to observe a dip in the flux at 1216 angstroms, and the rest of everything will remain the same as that of the source. Now suppose we increase the density of the hydrogen cloud in the region. In that case, more number of Lyman alpha photons will get absorbed, and the amount of dip in the flux will also increase. So we can estimate the density of hydrogen gas from the strength of the absorption line in the spectra. Well, this is the picture when we have our source at a redshift of 0. Now consider source at a redshift of say z equals 1, meaning that the source is 8 billion light years away. Now in this case, those photons will get absorbed by the gas, which started off at a shorter wavelength, and due to the cosmic expansion, their wavelength got redshifted to 16 angstroms at the site of the cloud. For this example that we're discussing, we'll observe a dip at 608 angstroms. Now let's apply this understanding to the spectrum of quasar. So here's the spectrum of the quasar, which we would observe had there been nothing between the quasar and us, and also after factoring out the redshift. We'll see an absorption at laminar wavelength due to the hydrogen gas right at the source, something like this. But now consider gas at a redshift of 2.8. Here, those photons will get absorbed, which started off at a shorter wavelength, and by the time they reach here, their wavelength got redshifted at 16 angstroms. Now they can interact with the hydrogen, so we see a dip corresponding to those photons right here. Similarly, for a gas cloud at a redshift of 2.2, even shorter wavelength photons will get absorbed, and this will happen all the way up to the redshift of 0. Combining all this finally gives you something that looks like this, like a forest, and therefore known as the Lyman alpha forest. You may want to pause this video to let this sink in. Now this suggests something interesting. Had there been uniform distribution of hydrogen along the path from quasar to Earth, then for all the wavelengths smaller than 12 16 angstroms, there would always be some hydrogen cloud in the course that will absorb them once they get redshifted to 12 16 angstroms. So we would expect to see significant suppression of flux for all these wavelengths, also known as the Gunn-Peterson trough. But the presence of this forest indicates that the hydrogen in the universe is not distributed uniformly. Instead, it is concentrated in specific regions, when everywhere else it's either ionized because ionized hydrogen cannot interact with the Lyman alpha photons, or simply not present. So we have a complex filament-like distribution of hydrogen in the universe, with density changing by factors of thousands to a million between a filament and its surroundings. However, this is the case only up to the redshift of 6. If we observe the spectra from a quasar with a higher redshift, like for example this one, we see almost zero flux for these wavelengths. Remember that specifying redshift is equivalent to specifying the time in history. Higher redshifts means you're essentially talking about the very early universe. The discovery of the trough in a quasar of redshift 6.28 and absence of trough in the quasars detected at redshifts just below 6 presents strong evidence that the universe's hydrogen has transitioned from neutral to ionized around z equals 6. This is known as the reionization phase of the universe. It's pretty incredible that just by simply checking for what redshifts we observe a trough and for what we observe the forest in the spectrum of quasars, we can learn about when this reionization phase has started. Well, there are even more applications to this Lyman alpha forest. It can even tell you about the nature of dark matter. It can also help us map the universe's distribution of matter. Interested viewers can read more on this. But to end off on a lighter note, here's something interesting. We now understand that the hydrogen in the universe is present in filament-like structures. And where there is ample hydrogen, we naturally have galaxies forming there. So you can imagine these filaments as the intergalactic highways for your spaceship if it could scoop up interstellar hydrogen and use it as fusion fuel. Then you are well advised to follow the track of such a filament, even if it does not represent the shortest path to the destination. In other words, stay in the darkest part of the Lyman alpha forest